As you can see, this is Patsy McGrillis and Ivor Canning having a look around this ancient site, and Patsy's actually going to introduce it here in more detail in a second or two. Okay, Patsy.
Now, this is a short film commissioned by the Banagher Feeny Historical Society with film by John McElhinney at Dungiven. The purpose of this film is to present features of local history as told by local people. Now, in our first adventure, we are very lucky to be favoured with excellent weather as the sun sets on this, the 21st of June 1995. We are assembled at a ring of stones on the Canning family farm in Altnaheglish, about 1.5 miles southeast of Feeny village. Ivor Canning is here present to enlighten us in more detail about these stones. So hope you enjoy the film.
Now, as you see these stones, this stone circle, this reminds us again of the ancient civilization of thousands of years ago known as the sun worshippers. These people had neither light, nor houses, nor time. The only thing they had got was the sun, so they're known as the sun worshippers. So they worshipped the sun, so they brought the sun down to the earth, as you can see in this circle. They had several gods at that time. They had the North Star, the solar system, as they saw on the solar system. All the stars went round the solar system, the North Star. And then they also had the moon. So you can see these two markers are known as north-south. They're directly north-south. And this one here is known as the hailstone on the northern side. And this one here is chamfered off towards the south. And this stone here, at high noon today, on the 21st day of June, that's when human sacrifice was done somewhere around this area. Now, as I said, the moon was another one. They had the equinox. Now, they celebrated always the equinox. And if they wanted to plant or do anything, they never planted at a waning moon, when the moon was decreasing. Always planted when the moon was increasing. That gives them more growth. And all these things, that was very superstitious thing. At certain times of the year, or these feast days that they had, they assembled around these stones and they walked right round these stones with lighted fire, right round the circle. And that gave the sun more power for the next year, because they had no time and there no heat, and they thought the sun only went round them. This great god risen on the east and every day, and went down in the west. And it was the only source of information they had. If the sun would, when it came to the winter time, if they thought that the sun wouldn't come back again. So this is why they went round with these lights, to give the sun more power. Now, on the different feast days, we have the markers up here. As you can see, these are the feast days. And the feast days were moved by the setting sun. And that told that what time of year they were able to show, the longest day and the shortest day of the year. When St. Patrick came here to Ireland, he found they had all these gods, so he wanted to give them the real true God. So he doesn't take away from the feast days. He gives them the God, and then Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That was three gods they had. They couldn't understand how three gods could be, and one God. So he lifted a shamrock from the ground, the three heads and one stem. So that's how he showed them Christianity. So it didn't take away from their day. He brought them to have this celebration, the same celebration, round these stones, and he preached them Christ. And he took the round O for the sun, and he put the cross through the round O, which is known as the Celtic cross. And that's how Christianity come. So, in a short time, we'll see again when the sun sets on the west, we'll be able to line up the stones for the longest day of the year. Now, you can see this is a southern martyr. If you stand at this point here, this martyr had fallen and has only been erected up a very short time. So I had to come here and stand and make myself the martyr to find out how the rising sun worked out, how it worked the time. Now, my shadow, the sun would be over there, the rising sun. So here we've got the martyr here. And you see, when you get two stones together, when you find two stones together, that would be the 21st day of March. That would be the equinox. So you can see that all these different feast days as well, so you'd have to come here every morning to get the feast days. There's quite a lot of these. As you can see, there's quite a lot of stones. But they had all these different times for sowing and reaping, and all, this was a calendar. This was a calendar. This was, they had no other time, only these stones, and this was their calendar. And they could tell all the days of the year, they divided the year into four parts, the longest day and the shortest day, and then the equinox is the ones in between, the 21st day of December and the 21st day of March, that's the equinox. And them, the days that they were very superstitious, what way, the one blue, and they could tell the time of the year. Because they only had 11 fish and hunt. There's no oil, and if the camera moves around, you can see all the valley where all the rivers are. So you see, this was a civilization. And I think that they mainly lived in fish, because all the valleys would be, at that time, wouldn't be drained, and there'd be a lot of bogland in the valleys. And it'd be a great place for fish in them days. So, Lord disturbed the fish at that time. And I'm sure the Lord sent them plenty of food, because there was no other way man could live in them prehistoric days. Because they had no even home, they all had to live in holes and caves and under the ground. And skins to keep them warm. And this is our ancestors, and you'll find all these circles all over Ireland and Britain and North Europe. And as these people come west, they brought this cult with them. Very difficult to put a time on these stones. These stones would be thousands of years, because Christ 2,000 years ago, and St. Patrick come at 300 and plus, he found the people worshipping these stones and moving around them. And that was the Druids. And he converted the Druids, as I said earlier, to the one living God. And Christ was the Son of the living God and the Holy Spirit. That was the three gods and the one Godhead and the shamrock. And it was very, very easy for them to convert, because they had lots of gods. They had the sea gods, and the moon gods, and the star gods, because when they looked up into heaven, in the canopy of heaven, they saw all the stars. And the one that they focused their attention was the solar system, the North Star. For the North Star, every other star paid tribute to it because they moved around it. And they called that the Queen of Heaven. And I've, one of the books of the Bible, I think it's Jeremiah, said that the Babylonians poured out oil onto the Queen of Heaven. That was abominable to the living God, because God was the only God. The point of this stone to the point of the disc, that is the line of the sun. That's the line the sun will be in another 10 or 15 minutes time. So as Patsy moves the disc across, a full sun on the upper side of that stone when she disappears onto the horizon. And that's the longest day of the year, and it'll stay there 2 or 3 days and then it'll move back behind that stone. And that's how they knew the longest day. Now the sun has become on the top of the horizon. And she just dropped down, she's on the top of the two lines of the two stones, and she'll come a full sun to the upper side of that stone. She'll stay there for approximately 2 or 3 days, then she'll move behind the stone and go by the south.
Very, very good. We're very lucky now to have an evening like that. It was maybe 20 years when we get another evening like it on this particular day.
You see, it's right.
As long as it's in due sort like this before. Well,
it's 5 or 6 years.
There's always a cloud.
You can see the sun has disappeared over the horizon. Perfect shot, not 1 degree out. And all them thousands of years when the man brought them stones, the sun is perfect to this present day.
This may have been a very, very educating thing for me and for the wife. And your own wife, I presume she hadn't been up here for quite a number of years.
Right.
And the son John here. And also to the filmmaker John McElhinney, because I think he didn't know very much about it either.
Well, I hope you all enjoyed it.
And we certainly enjoyed it, and we're more than pleased to have you, to have us up here on your farm here. And it's very, very, very welcoming.
Thanks very much for coming.
Well, congratulations to you, Maggie, on your...
Well, thank you, Patsy.
It's very, very nice to see you looking so well. And you went to school in Banagher?
I went to Banagher in school.
Right.
The whole crowd of us, about 20.
20
would gather up all together and we'd all go to school.
Right.
Oh, they're a big crowd, you know.
Oh, well, there's a big crowd of population around the country areas then in
the
rural areas.
The Browns went to Manayokan School, and the Bettys.
Oh, that.
And that, when we went over then to the Gala Corner, there was maybe 7 or 8 of the Danish Kellish ones.
And one with it another, is that the idea?
What? One with it another.
One with it another.
One with it another.
And there's the quite a crack of a thing.
And the Badney Dibbins. And her, someone pushing the Badney Dibbins would come round from Green to the country.
Oh, aye, aye, right.
Now, would you remember any of the teachers who were at the school, or many teachers were in the school at that time?
There was one teacher in every end of the school, Master Willie McGaggy, teached in the boys, and Miss O'Keehan teached in the girls.
Oh, see that. Very good. Well, they're all talking about nowadays the great times and all together. What kind of times were at school then?
Oh, well, far better times than us now.
I think so.
Far better. They were teaching manners.
Well, very good, Maggie, I might know. That's one point that's very important, I must say now.
Yeah, they were teaching manners. And with the both at the school.
And then now, there's some of the children now go to school to their age of 16 and then they go on ahead maybe to university.
I know that.
Now, what age did you, when you left school?
I left school and went back to it for another year or two. I left school in November of 1911 and I went over to Green House to nurse Sponsy Glen for about a month.
Right. Well, what age were you then, Maggie? What age did you leave school actually at?
I was only about 11.
11, aye.
Aye.
And I would imagine that when you arrived...
I went back to school again then and I put in the 3 months or 4 months. It was over in the green.
Oh, aye, right.
Aye.
Oh, you could leave and go back again if you wished.
Oh, aye. No.
No compulsory?
No compulsory.
No, right. Well, then I would imagine then whenever you got home every evening there'd be a wee bit of work to do.
Yeah. Maybe a couple in a month in October would I get in the big parties.
Oh.
Maybe you would have a couple of plots of parties together.
Right. Imagine that. Aye.
Aye.
And then most of those potatoes were all used for peeling the stock where they were, as well as the household.
Well, I tell you, there weren't so much stock about the places at that time.
Oh, was that so?
No, there weren't a big flock of cattle either.
No.
Not at all.
Just
kept it on them.
Just kept it on
them.
People were self-sufficient, in other words.
They were, fat-a-level.
Fat-a-level, was it. Right. Well then, as you grew up then, after school times in your teenagers, what was life like then, like for a teenager?
Well, it wasn't much. You had to pack it about, and if you got a day's work, you went out and took it.
Mm. Well, as you talk about a day's work, Maggie, how much would you get for a day's work then?
Well, I'll tell you what the men was getting. 8 shillings a week.
8 shillings a week? My goodness. That wouldn't buy very much nowadays.
Others them worked for 1 shilling a day.
Imagine, and I would imagine it would be a very, very hard work in a whole lot of cases.
No, it wasn't hard.
I always thought it was harder then than it does now.
I tell you, digging pretties wasn't hard. The men dug the pretties and the women gathered them.
Gathered them, right. Then they pitted them then, didn't they?
They pitted them.
That's right.
Stepped some of the and pitted them.
Well, that was... A very, very, very nice, healthy job, I would imagine.
It was.
They always said...
One job I had 8 summers together, pretty soon.
Oh, that's so? Very good. Well, and then the corn too to be gathered up, I suppose.
The corn was moved at that time, in my young days, with the scythes.
Oh, aye, right.
And if we had nobody to mow, my father was a man, he never was used mowing. We mowed for the neighbours.
Oh, right.
Well, then we'll come to move for us.
The morning, I heard tell of the morning, that was a big thing at the time too, and it was a very good idea, wasn't it?
What's that?
The morning, as you talked about.
The morning was a very good idea.
Very good. It seemed to create a better neighbourliness, and people were always...
Which is a bit of kindness.
Kindness, that's right. You work for me, and I work for you, so to speak.
That was the way it was. Thinning turnips and...
Oh, that was great, you know.
Surely.
Then the turf and the potatoes and all.
That'd be pretty soon in the turf.
That's right.
You like a job for you.
Then, I remember now, when I was at school, there was lunch.
That's right.
But there'd be much more work than that to be done in that time too, your days.
There were, not so much, only the pulling.
Just the pulling, aye.
The pulling was the worst.
That was a hard one.
The neighbours
rallied
round all
of
them and
forked
the lunch.
That's right, I remember my father having lunch right now.
That's right.
He had no farm, but he took land.
I know, took it.
Well, then, now, what about dances and things like that? Were there many of those, Maggie, about that?
Well, some of the ones that were the lunch, they were if they had a band, they gave a lump playing dance in the band.
Oh, see there, right.
And the men didn't attend the lump playing. There were no dance for them.
Oh, I see. No, you couldn't just jump in and...
No, they didn't, no. They just attend the lump playing.
Well, tell me this now, what's any music? Or
with
anybody to play the music in the dance?
There weren't
the music,
the fiddle was.
Oh, aye, right.
There weren't many accordion players at the time.
No, just fiddles.
The fiddles.
Now,
would
you remember any of those
who
played the fiddles at that time?
Paddy O'Kane, I could have been a fiddle player. And Rosie McFeeny.
Oh, aye, Rosie, she went to America.
Mrs. McFeeny.
Right.
Was a
fiddle
player.
Right.
And Wally Nellis was a
fiddle
player.
Oh, Wally Nellis, I remember
and,
Wally.
And Jimmy Carr Hassan.
Yes,
my name. He was a
fiddle
player.
That's
that was
right.
On your side.
Right. Over in your end, and then there'd be different other title lands that have fiddlers too, is that it?
Sure.
Aye. Weddings. They're a big thing nowadays, and always have been, I would imagine.
They were a big thing nowadays, right enough. But they were far better than the old times.
Right. Where did they have the receptions then?
Most of the receptions was at home.
All at home, right.
At home.
And where were the honeymoons spent? Honeymoons?
Maybe in the house. Cutting turf.
I think so. Well, they wouldn't be going to the house to cut turf nowadays, are they? Are there any happy memories?
There were no cars for weddings.
No cars?
No cars, unless they went in a cart.
Right. Oh, aye.
And the driver maybe some at night.
Imagine that. The weddings would be on what days of the week would it be then at that time?
How'd you say?
What days of the week would they be on at that time?
It would be sure to be a Tuesday evening or a Thursday evening.
Oh, always in the evening?
Mostly.
Imagine. Who cares? And then they'd have the reception and the dance at the home again.
Well, I wonder if there's any room for that.
Oh, see.
That would be the point.
Uh-huh.
There would have been some other, the neighbour's house.
Right.
Oh, that's all right.
Well, would you remember, Maggie, any particular wedding that you stand out in your memory? Do you remember any particular wedding, Maggie, had?
I mean, Master McGuigan's wedding. My schoolmaster's wedding.
Oh, right, right. Yeah. He was married. He'd be married in Altnaheglish Dam, wouldn't he, Maggie?
No, he was married in Banagher. There were no weddings in the only in the parish chapel at the time.
Oh, is that so?
That's
so. Nobody knew that now.
Aye. Mm. That'd be about, I think, 1900.
Yeah, it's a magic. Aye.
September.
September? Oh, well, you're good and you can remember that, Maggie. So that was very good. And then, was he coming in a cart or what way was it?
He came in a side car, a white horse, I think there were two cars. Who owned the other? Mickey, I think maybe Mickey Hassan's.
Mm.
Mickey and Pat Paul Green. I couldn't tell you, but Mickey,
oh, well.
Mickey Finney's afternoon was one of them.
Very good. Well, that'll be one for the bride and one for the groom, is that right?
That was it.
Oh, I see. And then what about the guests?
Well, no big push of guests.
Not a big push, just
no,
a few.
No big push, yes.
And just make their own way.
No money for a big push.
No, I suppose that's another point, Mike. I never think about that.
No money for a big push.
Funny incidents on any of the weddings
of
the past?
Well, this wedding that come from Milk and Banham to be married in Banagher.
Right.
And they went up through Coolamore and on up past the Danone, where Danone lived.
Oh, right.
And Mickey, there was a man playing. And he lit a wee bottle. And he let the horses stand in the field and he bought it the wedding.
Imagine, just like that.
Aye.
Just like that.
He bought it the wedding. And when it come to dark, the horses put the bride out of the field and was making for home with two very women drinking and bought them.
Goodness, oh. But you get a bit of a shock and you come back and no play there.
I came back for 2 days. The wedding lasted that long.
2 days?
Aye.
Well, that's a good advice, maybe. Day one, day now, they'll be talking about it.
They were more than handful for it.
Right.
They were more than hand for it.
Oh, that's so.
Yeah, he wasn't grown.
And then they'd have a bit light and all.
Aye.
What's the living in those days now? Do you know anything about that, ma'am? She was.
The cost of living was very, very cheap.
Very cheap.
Very cheap.
Hmm. Even whenever there was little money.
There was little money, but then it didn't cost much to get what you needed.
Ah, I see. Now, for instance, when you mention that cost, I'd be interested to know as having a shop. I'd be interested to know now what the cost of any particular item, would say tea or sugar or a loaf or eggs.
Well, a loaf of bread, and it'd be that size.
Right.
Any cakes.
Oh, that's down where Patsy Murphy's living now.
For Patsy Murphy's living now.
Right.
Down in Jack's shop, you've got a big loaf and a pot of jam. It wasn't a pot, it was a jug.
Oh, a jug of jam.
A jam, you thought.
Right.
For a dozen eggs.
A loaf, a big loaf, I remember, the big
loaf.
And then a pot of jam, a jug of jam for a dozen eggs.
A dozen eggs.
Well, a dozen eggs nowadays would be about 92 pence, would be almost a pound. What would you got for a dozen eggs then, about?
Minimum.
About, just the 5 pence.
Huh?
And that, of course, everybody had hens and they were able
everybody
to...
Everybody had hens, surely.
That was part of the game.
And there were maybe something at a butter to sell to.
Aye. You know idea what price an ounce of snuff would have been then?
Tuppence.
That's a big change now.
Back in the cigarettes, a penny.
A penny. Well, now that packet would have been 5 or 10 or 20.
Five.
Aye. Five woodbine probably.
Five for a penny.
Aye.
Five woodbines for a penny.
Five woodbine for a penny. That's right, I thought that now. So therefore, well then now, how did you do for feeding for the hens? Had you just fed with potatoes or what?
Oh, I
put you
in the meal. Yeah, the meal was about 8 shillings a day.
Well then, where did you get that at, Maggie?
What?
Where did you get the meal at? Where did you get the meal, the yellow meal at?
From Father McGuigan had a van on the road.
Oh,
George Gorney had a van on the road.
Where did he live at? Where did he from?
Up from Craic.
Oh, Craic.
Yeah. Shop's all going there in Craic. Yeah.
Oh, he come round that way.
He come round.
Yes.
A horse and van.
Horse and van, right.
A copper dump van.
Uh-huh.
Like a gypsy's van.
Oh, imagine.
Aye.
Very interesting. And then, I remember now, my father, hope it's happy, he used to work in Poston's Mill. And they'd done something with the meal too, but I was too young to know what they did do.
You didn't make the corn.
Aye.
And the oatmeal.
Right.
Aye.
And then what did they do with it then?
With the oatmeal.
Aye.
The oatmeal was and if you had plenty of it, you could give a handful into the animals.
Oh, aye, that's what it was used for mostly.
And the hens hardly ever got the oatmeal.
Did they not?
And they were still a bit made out of it.
Hmm.
And there was oat bread made out of it.
Oh, aye, right.
The oat.
Uh-huh.
Around the
apartment,
having in front of the
fire. Oh, imagine, that would be very nice, man. I say that the happy days then, with people working and that's all right.
My mother used to make a scone of bread in front of the fire.
Yes.
And she would have left it before the carriers come, she was all right.
Oh, you had plenty of carriers, didn't you, Maggie?
I mean, I'd pat an ale on them, and to his, Thomas Cairn and Barney Kelly were there, they carried ways.
Right.
Aye. And the Kelly's fell.
Oh, yeah,
no, Danny's here, there, eh? And Pat and Neil took a wee bit of the old bread and he looked at my mother and he says he'd make quite good taste to see a bit of butter on it. You might put a big pint of butter in front of Pat for a dollar on.
Oh,
thank you. You've got a bit of butter for him anyway, man. I think she'd shave a wee sip of tea, Pat, and be dead with her. Scrambled, she'd be like it worked.
Well, mind you, that was some crack, wasn't it?
It was.
The killing, as you mentioned, the killing there, were a lot of people killing everywhere there.
They were killing everywhere. They had their houses.
Then were there many people travelling around, like people who had no homes?
Oh, the tramps?
Aye.
Oh, plenty of them.
Plenty,
3 and 4 times a week you would see them.
Imagine. Some changes since then.
They were lodging with people.
Oh, the people with fish or something.
She's in the corner.
Aye.
Want to be happy in the morning.
Morning, as long as they've got a roof over their head, as the sailors. As long as they've got a roof over their head.
As long as they've got a roof over their head,
and I'd imagine that they've got a bed, that's right. They would be turned away.
No, it wouldn't turn away.
Well, people are blessed for doing that too, you know.
That was surely.
You know.
There's many a poor old bee and there's needed to rest.
Oh, indeed, that's right. Now, Maggie, what would be your memories now as a young girl in the village of Feeny in that time?
It was all right.
And I suppose there was a fair good population about it.
Well, there was a very good population, not as good now as better now.
It's better now, yeah, right? It would be a hard question to ask you, would you know any of the people who lived there at any time?
Well,
in your life, or where they lived.
Montgomery's big house. Dean says it now.
Oh, aye, Gustavus at the presbytery.
That at one time had been a priest's house.
Oh, is that so?
Aye. Father Cairn. Aye. Oh, he was changed the way down and then down until he gone.
Aye.
I don't mind him.
Right.
But he's not such a very long time.
Mm.
And Faith's.
Well, I remember.
And then below Faith's there was two wee tenant houses or riches.
Well, mine.
Riches lived in one of them.
That's right, White Side.
And Aggie Book lived in.
That's right.
After she married.
And previous to that, I think now I remember a man that called a Wally Wrigley, might have been McLaughlin.
Wally Wrigley and Jimmy Wrigley lived in their mother, I'd see him.
Right.
The three of them lived together then, and then he died, and Wally then lived himself there away.
Right.
That's right.
Mm.
And Benny Dormer.
Oh.
Benny Dormer lived there when Righty was living.
Oh, aye, that's right.
And then Miss Ritchie's house, where Duncan's living now.
Yes.
Ritchie's shop.
That's right.
And then where young Lynch is living, had belonged to Paddy Curtin.
Oh, aye, right.
And had her still let out for a tenant house, tenants.
Oh, I see that, right.
And where Norman Dean used to live was Moore's.
Oh, I read.
And Bob Lynch owned where Martin Hamilton's living.
Hmm.
He owned the post office.
Oh, and that was there.
And the...
That time?
The posting car.
Hmm.
He had a car.
Oh, aye.
And then I think the barrack was then where John Evans' house is there.
Oh, right.
The Iron Barrack,
that's quite some time ago.
And then there was another house you brought to, what do they call it, McAspan, Jim McAspan.
Uh-huh.
That was a two-story house at the time.
Oh, well, that was up above the barrack at that time.
Something back just above the barrack.
Mm.
And then Jim McAspan went away till he went away for him, a long way, a year and then he got him.
Imagine that.
And they're not, Bob not had a house, and Davy not had a house, and Joe not had a house.
Oh, that's
it. Tenants of Ritchie's.
Ritchie's, aye. Was that the small houses that used to go
up? Small houses.
That's right, I think I remember them, vaguely remember them.
And Jimmy McKinley had the carpenter shop there.
Oh, aye, right.
And a wee shop that you're on.
That's right, aye, I remember that.
And then the wee house that
didn't Jimmy do the undertaking for the area?
He didn't surely. He don't know undertaking.
That's
surely.
Right.
He don't know undertaking.
Mm.
Him and Deans.
Oh, aye, right.
Aye.
Uh-huh.
Well, then the...
Deans, as you mentioned, Deans, that would be... what Deans was that, Maggie?
That was Norman's father. Our Davy.
Oh, Davy Deans. Oh, aye, right.
Well, that would finish that side of the street.
Uh-huh.
And then the wee church is there.
That's right. Well, that's where we're operating from as a matter of interest.
I know.
For the historical group.
I know that.
Yeah, that's...
Well, then the hotel was the next.
Oh, there's a hotel in Feeny too.
There was. Tom Keane and Mrs. O'Kane's hotel in Feeny.
Right. Where was that position, Mike?
That's where the sportsman's animal is now.
Right.
There.
Uh-huh. And then, as you mentioned, a hotel, what use would, like, what Would the big crowds go into it, or what way was it?
No, there were no big crowds at that time for hotels.
No,
there was they made tea for travelers or something that would come around.
Yes.
And
would any people stop on it now?
Perhaps? No, there's a fish lodge in it for a while.
Oh, is that so? Was he in the parish now?
He was in the Ford Glen. There were no house for the priest.
Oh, I see now.
No.
Presumably a hard question to ask you if you remember his name now.
Father Bradley. Father Bradley was on it.
Oh, see now, right. Very good, that's very nice.
What?
You have a great memory, Maggie.
Father Bradley christened me.
Pardon?
Father Bradley christened me.
Oh, is that so?
Aye.
Well, then he was there at that time. Right.
No, he wasn't there. He was living out. Did you know where Mary Rusby's house was out?
Oh, I did surely out at the Gospel Hall there.
That's where I was christened out there.
You were christened out there?
I was.
How was that, Maggie? What was it?
Father Welsh was there.
Yes.
And Father Bradley was stopping out in that house.
Right.
Hugh Dibbon had it at the time.
Oh, right. And then you were taken out there to be baptised?
I was taken out there to be baptised.
Imagine that. That's strange, isn't it?
Aye.
And why was it? Father Walsh was dead at the time you were baptised, or was he long dead?
Well, I think that I was born with it. I get my birth certificate as December.
Oh, aye.
You know, in that times.
Yes.
As I was registered, they made the birth date in Alabama.
Oh, I see. Right.
Father Walsh died in October, I think.
Oh, I see now, right. Oh, well.
You see his headstone there.
Aye, that's right, there's a problem. Well, anyway, moving on down the street now, could you visualise any other houses? There was a blacksmiths or something, wasn't there?
There was three blacksmiths in Feeny. Wally Aiken was a whitesmith.
Oh, aye.
And Paddy Brodick was a blacksmith that really left and went away for him.
Right.
And Mahoney.
Oh, I mind the Mahoney's already. In other words, then there was two blacksmiths and one whitesmith.
Aye.
Oh, I see now, right. That was a going place. And I remember when I was a boy taking shoes over to a man over in Feeny to get them fixed, leaving them over and going back again.
Felix,
I think. Felix, do you remember much about him now?
Well, I wonder where he lived now. Who come after Tom Gaines now? Who's next to that now?
Tom Keane. On down, that'll be the Mahenys and the...
Who'd have met now? Montgomery's.
Montgomery's.
Montgomery's come first. There's another house there.
That was after the hotel, you mean? There's Mahenys, or not... Wally Aiken, was he not there?
Well, Wally Aiken had... He still lodged.
Oh, I see.
He had no residence.
Right.
No, he had no residence.
Mm.
And then where Mick McKinney's house is there, that was Dean's carpenter ship.
Oh, is that so?
Aye, right.
They had made kirks and all that kind of stuff at that time.
Kirks and dressers and
everything. Bars.
Everything that was needed.
Right. Well, that was very... For people in that those days were...
And then Mahoney's house. And there's another house there. Mickey Donner's living in it.
Oh, aye, that's right. That's...
That belonged to Beck Stewart.
Right.
And then she left it till... She left it to the... To the family keep you ticket that time. She left it to put up a hall.
Right.
Open. I don't know if they took it or not.
Aye.
I think the fates may be good.
Oh, aye, right.
And then the sport are the Anne Bradley's. That was the pub.
Oh, was that the... I remember a pub there. I think it was whatever Aiken said was the Empire Bar.
The Empire Bar?
Is that right?
That was Anne Bradley's.
I remember the same one.
Mick Kelly was married on Mick and Anne Bradley's daughter, Mary Kelly.
Oh, I want to say that, right?
And Anne Bradley was up from Draperstown. She still with her own maiden name.
Moving on up there now, beside the bar there now.
That's Becky then at the Temperance Hotel.
Oh, was there another hotel in Finney?
Aye.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Becky stayed at the Temperance Hotel.
Right.
And then there was a house.
That'll be very interesting. I'd like to hear a lot about that now.
There was a house then of all that. And it was, you could, if you wanted to get into the cow market, there was a right of way there to get into the cow market.
Oh, see, that was way up for Feeny Road.
Where Lynch is, or Kerry's house is in the cow market.
Oh, it is, sure, aye. Well,
that's the cow market.
That's the cow market, aye. Then you had to have a right of way to get, there was a right of way into that.
There was a right of way to get on there.
From the main street.
And then Paddy Carton then had, where Pace Lynch is living.
Was there a bar there at that time?
There were.
Oh, was that so?
There was a bar there too. Mm. And then on farther up, there were a house of McElhinney's there. There were nine tenants on it.
Oh, I read.
And then Felix's house.
Oh, that's the shoemaker.
The shoemaker. Mm. That was McElhinney's too.
Oh, I see.
And then the meat parochial.
I think I remember the broken air now, Maggie, right enough.
Aye.
That's right.
Aye, we.
Aye.
We're going to catch you.
Aye.
Aye.
Well, that's some changes.
And then there was another place there now, Davy Dean's, right, the first family on it.
Oh, say
that. Aye. And belonging to a man down in the homes, Craig.
Oh, aye, right.
And then Archie Biggs Barron.
Barron, that was on up there too.
Aye, that was up there.
Right.
Up where the Bundy Murphy lived in the cottages.
Oh, aye. Very good. I would like to hear a wee bit more about the Temperance Hotel.
Temperance Hotel was there when I went out to a lot of customers.
Oh, that's so?
Aye.
No alcoholic drink at all?
No alcohol drink. Oh. Didn't need the whiskey, was that cheap.
Oh, is that so?
I don't realise what price it was.
Well, do you remember about what price it was?
It was 2 shillings a pint up in Reddy's.
Right, 2 shillings a pint in Reddy's?
Aye, and pounds of whisky. Brown, clear whisky.
Well.
Aye.
It wasn't important by any chance, no? Was that available around the countryside?
Oh, there were plenty of bottling, but...
Bottling, aye.
That was only a shilling a bottle.
Oh? Yeah. Then, about the hotel, were many people stayed in it, or was there any sort of business about it?
And the Temperance Hotel? Aye. There were no business about the Temperance Hotel, unless Stoney had left the night.
Stoney it?
Which a wooden roof was on it.
Right.
Aye. The very poor was storing it.
Oh, my goodness.
But
well.
Meant it well.
But she wouldn't have been a great business person, was she not?
Not at all. She had this water lane and gave it up on the Monday for an advertisement.
Oh,
aye. There might be some times a women are going to take, you know, to have a yarn well.
More of a Kelly house than anything else?
Sometimes just come out to that. When she was in Newmarket.
Oh, I say that to tell you, oh well. But still, she was there anyway.
She was all dressed in jewellery.
Oh, is that right?
Oh, very swanky jewellery.
Where is she a native of?
That's what I don't know, that's where she lived there.
Just lived there, she was one of the native of Feeny anyway.
Well, I think the rest of them belong to Feeny.
Aye, right. Mm. Well, do you know, Maggie, there's the market you told us about, the market, the right way up to the market there, a few minutes ago.
Aye.
Now, would you remember anything about the market?
The cow market.
The cow market, aye.
That was Feeny Fair for the cattle that the cow market was.
Oh, aye, just only cattle.
Cattle, sheep and pigs.
Pigs, right.
And men are women if you want them to buy.
You could. And you could buy a woman as well, or a man.
You could buy a woman or a man at the time.
Was the price as high for them?
What?
Was the price as high for the men or the woman?
Well, you nearly get the woman cheaper than the cow at that time. The price wasn't there.
Oh, well.
No, cattle was only the best animal you could get. You get about £12 for it.
I think so, £12.
Need to be a good one.
I think so, imagine. £12.
And then if they weren't in good condition.
That would have been the early 1900s.
That was £7 or £8.
Aye.
And it need to be a good cow or about 13 pounds.
13 pounds, imagine that.
Aye.
And other, well, of course you could bring it.
The market, the fairs was held on the 1st of January. And on Christmas Day. And maybe.
Well, Maggie, I must say that you have a marvellous memory of all your young days and later on in years. And we'd like to thank you very much for your...
I could go back, yep. You stepped in touch happen enough.
Do you think that? No. Well, now, I think we've covered a fair amount of it now.
I was over to Freeman's one time for a pint of nuts. Freeman's across the water.
Oh, aye.
And when I went on to Freeman's, the pint bottom, if you get a pint of cream, my own cows was dry. And Maggie Freeman gave me 2 shillings. And she'd take that bottle away and go and get me a pint of Curry's whiskey up in Vegas.
Right.
So I said, what? I went, put me down the fence and one too particular for dressing it. And when I was coming out, Dan Matthews usually was about Freeman's. And these old boys, Aikens, was our friends of Maggie's, was drinking about it. Dan was getting known.
Right.
And Dan asked me where I was going, so I went to Maggie's for a pint of whiskey. He said, when you're coming, come back this road. And when I come back, Dan was looking at me. And I got him the fine bottle, and he took a good drink out of it, and he was down on the hill at the northern. Don't spout.
Oh, well, I spout.
Cut it up. Swimming for them again.
Cut it up for water, like?
Aye. Well, they wouldn't miss.
Lord, no, it was water down.
Not at all.
It was that strong.
I went in and Maggie had the milk ready for me in another bottle, and I made for home before they were joined to taste it. And Dan was over and told us again, said he didn't know the word. Sure, at all, said he. That whiskey account says you would have carried that. I could have drunk the half water and felt it. Never see, but I got a taste of it myself, it was all right.
I think so.
Aye.
That is a marvellous to tell, is it? You wouldn't like to care about doing it now, Maggie?
No. What else?
Oh, well. That's right. Oh, well. So, hey, Maggie, thank you very much indeed for your kindness, your time.
I've been sending good to you.
It's certainly very, very interesting, I must say, anyway. And I'm sure our fellow man, John McElhinney, will agree. And I'd like to have you get a wee bottle.
History Film. We have now arrived in the Banagher Glen, and it's the 16th of August 1995. And our location is the site of the mass rock, which is on our left here. I was very pleased also, indeed, to have Father McGuigan, parish priest of the parish of Banagher, with us tonight, accompanied by Brenton Kelly, who is very, very familiar with this area because he has lived and reared up in it. And also George Murphy is nearby as well. Two ladies with us this evening are Philomena Mulhern and Mary Kelly. I would like to also mention that before we came here this evening, last week, Brendan and George have cleaned up this place, as you can see, and it's very, very neatly done, and we're very pleased to see that. And maybe on a later date, maybe Mass could be celebrated here. So I'll hand you over now to Brendan Kelly to give you a wee bit more information about the area.
Well, I remember coming to school down nearby here and looking across when I was small, sitting in a brew over there, seeing the mass rock here. That must have been 40 years ago now, around that. And I always heard the older people say that there's a cave nearby up here, but the quarry across the far side of the river there, a place of hiding for the people who were at mass, or likely for the priests at the time. Now I'd like to hand you over to Father McGuigan to say a few words.
Well, the mass rock would have been used between 1700, say, and 1750. That was the time of the penal laws. The penal laws first started in the 1690s, but they really got severe from up to 1710. And they would have been severe up until, say, the 30s at least. After 45, they relaxed a bit. Now, Mass would have been said here. It wouldn't have been said here certainly every Sunday. It would have been said here maybe once a month, or it all depended on, I suppose, conditions, the weather and everything else, and how safe it was. There would have been a priest right enough in this area, because the priests were registered and they had to stay in their own area, and they had no church, there's no churches, so they'd come here and say Mass at this rock for the people round about. And I'm sure there's other rocks in the parish too that would have done the same thing. And they would have said Mass, and I'd imagine they'd have heard confessions beforehand, and maybe gone round the district and attended the sick when they were saying the Mass. Now, that would have lasted up certainly into the 1740s. But I think the history says there's a church built in Banagher, Fincairn, 1755, so that would have finished the Mass rocks. So it's 250 years at least since Mass was said here.
I know this is not the real site of the zone. It was further over here near under the river bed here, on the side of the river here, around that area.
How then did it come to be up here?
Well, Father McNamee was in the parish of his happy at that time, and he got Fred Hogg to move the stone up on here to this site. So a digger of that, you know, a few men.
Alright, but then, like, why was that, like, you know?
They were dumping stuff in the far side of the river, and then the dump was too big and pushed the river over, and the river was going to come in contact with the stone and take the stone eventually with it, you know, downstream.
Yeah. Right.
So rather than that, Father McNamee wanted to stay where it was, or close by, you know what I mean?
Yes.
So we left in a fairly safe place here.
Sheltered place as well.
So it'll be down in the flat there somewhere.
It was definitely down in the flat, I'd say now, it was surely.
I suppose possibly there would have been no bushes up that other bank at that time too, and people could have, you know.
That's purely clear there. I'll tell you one time I remember that no bank there at all, it was just a road along, you know, on the far side there.
Oh, yes.
And then there's so much dumped over this way, you know, maybe 20 or 30 yards this way, you know, and pushed the river this way too, you know what I mean?
Yes. Is there a wall, kind of a wall built there?
That's that hard rock, what's it called, quarry dust there.
Oh, is it quarry dust,
Baked for tight together, you see.
Yes.
And then the river took so much away every flood, you know what I mean?
I see, yeah. Yes.
or any other mass thoughts about the new Grundy?
Well, it's one up in the big dam area, you know, the water area.
Oh, right.
But it'd be perfectly safe to go over to now in this weather, I would say. Imagine the dry weather and that would be. It's bare back about a month or 5 weeks ago,
before you run there.
Past, it's up near the upper end of the dam.
Yes.
But a quarter of a mile from where the steam comes in, you know.
Down. Yes, where the steam comes into the dam.
That's right.
Yes.
So I remember being up about maybe 30 years ago and there were a very dry spell at the same time, summertime too. And it's funny, whatever I was doing with the dog, whatever, I didn't have time to go over, but I should have went over, you know, when it was so good, you know, come back later and went over, you know, that type of thing.
Right.
So I never seen Clear again over to it, you know.
Yes, yes.
Well, there's a danger with it too, you could sink very quick in that soft, mucky stuff.
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
But it'd be interesting to get over to it, to touch it even, you know, you're to see it, you know, what type of thing it is, you know.
You say it's dangerous, Brent, in normal circumstances even if it was bare. Is it because it's very soft ground, is it, or what?
Well, you've so much muck, John, has run down through the years from the sides, you know, I mean, pulled in.
Right.
That even your dwellings on you could bog in there and stay there to, unless you'd help with you, know, that type of thing.
Mm.
There's nothing as dangerous as that, it'll hold you very quick, you know.
Mm.
You have moss and gravel and sand and all mixed up.
No, I think we'll move down now to the original side, as you know where it was, don't you, Ben?
All right, that's all right, good. Yeah,
that's right. And so thank you all very much for your help and guidance.
Welcome,
but otherwise we would not be here.
All right. Fed Hogstein, the man at the quarry here, and then with the brew being taken away so much with the river, the floods, it started to go in here more. But at that time, I think the mass stone was out of it here somewhere, sitting about among these stones somewhere. And then the river at that time was out in this part, and it's going to be through time, it's getting back to its old position again, the river. It always went down that way there.
So then, did Father McNamee approach Fred Hogg at that time?
Oh, he did, surely, Joe. That was 1958, I think, around that.
Yes.
57 or 58, around that, I think.
Uh-huh.
58 would be there.
And the site was somewhere about that blue stone around there.
I think, John, at that time, there'd be a sort of wee home here, a home you could do the labour, you know, at that time, before that happened, you know. And then, there were millions of tons, like, they dumped there, you know. That side, and brought the blue over near the mast stone here, you know what I mean? So then Father McNamee noticed this, and he got removed up into a safe area at that time.
That's where those people that now are, and where we have left.
That's right, I would say, John, them few stones there were left to put the river more out that way, you know what I mean? They must have got a digger in here for these stones across to keep the water from down this way.
Right.
And sent more in by that dumped area there.
Right. It's funny how this area now has been preserved again, isn't it? This little island.
The river makes its way back, John, to its original place again, I can't, you know.
Right.
And funny, Father McNamee, we were crossing there, he had stepping stones made down there. An iron, what do you call them, crowbars on the river, you know, sunk in the river, and the big stones left on, you know, behind them, for the club to come away.
Oh, I see.
And I remember them being there fairly fresh, you know, that's right. Very fresh.
Yeah.
They were just down there, and about to be crossed there. Stones on the river, you know, and iron bars down behind them.
Yes,
I mean, a good job, that's right.
Yes.
But there's so many big flood fronts, you know, that's wrecked everything, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're not
afraid of the
stones?
No, not at all. It's beautiful up here.
Isn't it lovely?
It's gorgeous.
It's lovely indeed. And for the lovely evening we've had for this journey. And we've just been joined by Ivor and Mrs. Canning. We're very happy to have them with us. And we're very grateful to Brendan Kelly for all the information he's given us, you know. And to George Murphy, who made a way into the place possible. George came to Dublin to make it possible. So we're grateful to them all, you know.
Would you think she'll retire and make her way back out again?
I think so. It might be
waiting
before dark for us.
Before someone had fallen in the river in the dark.
Yeah.
Eh?
I'll see in the winter time there's plenty of water.
Oh, there's plenty of water in the fall.
Yeah.
Oh,
I'm sure.
Church stands on a glacial hill, partly now quarried away for sand and gravel. Its history begins violently in 1121, when an annal entry states that the King of Kinnoch was killed by his own kinsmen in the centre of the cemetery. We don't know if the church was founded then, or is, in fact, much longer established. Local tradition sees it as one of St. Patrick's foundations in the area, and the mason who carved the inscription on the west door in the 1730s stating, "This church was built in the year of God 474, clearly thought it was indeed founded by St. Patrick, which is quite possible. However, local tradition also ascribes its origin to St. McElhinney, but he doesn't appear in any early source of history, and even the date of his festival is not recorded. However, tradition has it that St. Murrough was led to this site by a stag from a church which is now a ruin in Temple Moyle, about half a mile away. What we are certain of is that this church is recorded as a parish church in 1306, and in 1397 it was chosen as one of Archbishop Colton's spaces during his visitation to the Derry Diocese. It is not clear when the church went out of use, but it was ruined in 1622 and became a subject of an antiquarian interest in the 19th century, when Bishop Reeves claimed it as one of the most interesting ecclesiastical ruins which remain in the diocese. It then passed into state care in 1880. In the 1970s, it was excavated and underwent a full excavation program. Here we have what must contain the remains of St. McElhinney. Dating from around 1210, it resembles a miniature church of carefully dressed stone, with the frame panel on the west gable showing an ecclesiastic with his hand raised in blessing. Since relics were a valuable asset to a church, and the importance of the Banagher relics is perpetuated in the still living tradition of Banagher sand. Sand from under the tomb has always been held to bring good fortune to members of the O'Heaney family. Its value is claimed
even in the world of horse racing, and the local Gaelic football club thought it wasn't bad either. Altnaheglish, Banagher, or the Pasture Dam. The name Altnaheglish means hill or valley of the church and probably dates from about the time of St. Patrick. Pasture is Irish for fabulous monster or serpent associated with water, by which the glen was known before the dam was built. The idea for this dam was first thought about by Derry City Council in 1918, and the first intake tank with a capacity for 40,000 gallon was built at the head of the Glenedra Valley, and it was supplying water to Derry through a 15-inch pipe in 1925. Well, the water ran unfiltered for 3 years, and each time there was a flood, it had to be cut off. The first filter house was built in 1930, and it was supplying water for the first time in 1931. This has, of course, been since replaced by a new filter house in Caw Hill. The main breast was also started in 1931, and the dam was formally opened on the 19th of November 1935. The breast is 67.5 feet thick at the base, and it rises to a height of 138 feet. The dam holds about 500 million gallons of water, and it has a surface area of some 70 acres. It has been designed to supply 3,500,000 gallons of water every 24 hours. Another interesting feature of this dam is that the site covers a mass rock which can sometimes be seen in very dry seasons, which isn't all that often, whenever the water is low. The building of this dam provided welcome employment, much of it local. Sadly, however, during the work there was one fatal accident when a man from Derry was killed by a falling plank as he worked at the bottom of a wall. During the winter months, there was no cover from the elements except for sheep shelters. However, one local man, Tony Smith of Tiavon, who was maybe more enterprising than most, he was employed as a night watchman, and he had his own idea of how to get a wee bit of comfort because he used to use a barrel to provide himself with some shelter. Many times he said he had a good night's sleep in it, for there wasn't too many people who went to steal an 18-pound sledge and nobody ever come near the place at night. I would believe him well. Growing of flax provided a much-needed boost to the income of many farmers. Consequently, flax mills, such as this one here, were to be found in many areas all over the north. It was in the Scotch mill that the flax was made ready for the market. Local markets were in Dungiven and Limavady, and in the early days horses and carts were used to transport the Scotch lunt, as it was then called, to both these centres. However, as the years went by, the horse and the cart gradually faded off the scene, and they were replaced by the tractor and the trailer. Here we see the water wheel which provided the power that drove all the machinery inside the mill.
Said I loved only you, Maggie, and you said you loved only me. Golden road of a blues shone, Maggie, and danced with fleas on the tree.
All the wheels, the rollers, all the machinery, now very rusty. This is where the flax was crushed and left ready for the scotchers who completed the work of preparation for the market. Over 50 years ago, this place was a hive of activity, and it was a means of providing much-needed employment for many people in the area. Wages at the time were not great by today's standards, with workers earning from 9 shillings to 1.5 shillings a week. That's from 45p to 1.25p. The working day was fairly long, from 8 in the morning until 7 in the evening, and conditions were extremely dusty, and if you stood in the doorway of the mill and looked in, you could hardly see a worker who would maybe be only about 6 feet away. Here we're looking at the site of an older mill, now completely grown over with grass and shrubbery.
Sang a song, Maggie, Robin sang loud on the breeze. When I first said I loved only you, Maggie, and you said you loved only me.
Photograph of some of the workers. Left to right in the back row, we have Susan McCluskey, James McSparn, Frank McCluskey, Frank McDevitt, Patrick McGrellis, Bernard McCluskey, Michael McGill, and Jimmy McGill. In the middle row, we have Sam Burke, Robert Knott, John Oliver, Joseph Knott, Patrick McDevitt, Joe McCluskey, John Hassan, Michael Hassan, Robert Thompson, James McCluskey, and John McGill. And squatted in the front are John McDevitt and David Knott. In this photograph here, we have in the back row, from the left to the right, John Hassan, Sam Burke, David Knott, James McCluskey, John Hassan, Michael Hassan, James McSparn, John Oliver, Robert Knott, Joseph Knott, and Frank Hassan. And in the front, from left to right again, we have Joseph McCluskey, Frank McCluskey, Bernard McCluskey, Patrick McGrellis, Susan McCluskey, Robert Thompson, John McGill, and Patrick McDevitt.
When I first said I loved only you.
Not too many here now. Only Fergal Hassan and his dog now frequent this area where all of these and many more worked to earn their weekly wage.
I love only you, and you said you loved only me.
Almost the end of our film on local history, and here we are this evening in the McCullough farm in Fincairn, and looking over here you can see a couple of bushes, a heap of stones, which I have been told by a Mr. Flanagan, who is an archaeologist, that it was a giant's grave. Furthermore, about the history of that, I can't say, so you can figure out your own thoughts about it yourself. 200 or 300 yards from Fincairn Old School, that was built in 1774, and new schools in Canada's Fincairn, on near hand here too, it was built in the mid-50s. Veteran Canada School, it is now called St. Joseph's Hall. It has belonged to the Ogilvy family, who had, they were controlling this area for a number of years, and they handed over the school to the parish priest, Father McGuigan, at the time, and it became now as known as Joseph's Hall, Banagher.
In the Ballydonegan here today, and John Hampson remembers a lot of people living in this area.
I remember a row of houses along here, the people living in them all, and now they're all derelict, and the people have all gone and left it now, and there's only a couple of new bungalows built now in the place, and that's all left, and there used to be 20 or 30 people living right around here, and now there's nobody at all, and you see the whole place now derelict.
But is this all the Ballydonegan, or is there another area, John?
No, there's another part of it. This is what they call a lower town, and the other part is called the upper town. It's two divisions, and it used to be a whole row of houses along here, and the road went right through onto the main road, right through here. That is the only road. The other road wasn't made at this time, and the people used to all live here. This is now the upper part of the town, as we used to call it. As you can see here, there's a whole row of houses right along here. And this used to be all occupied, and now there's not anybody living in it at all.
John, do you remember families living in these houses?
I remember three families living along here, these three houses along here, but that's they're all gone now. There's very few of them left about the place now. They're all moved into the city. I think some of their ancestors might be about, but none of the older people left.
How long ago would that be, John?
Well, it'd be 50 years ago, at least, anyway, since I remember anybody living in it. This is the sweat house now, or what's left of it. As you can see, it's a bit derelict looking. It used to be all covered over here, and this, at the lower part here, is the entrance to it. So you used to crawl in here and get the heat up, get all these ferns and all around here built up. They got a good heat in it. Then when they got a sweat on, they come out and got into this water, as you can see, passing here. And they went in there, and the always have a great belief that this is good for pains and stuff. I don't know. I wouldn't fancy going into it today, anyhow. Well, now have a wee look inside to see what it's like inside, but I don't think it's badly eaten up down with it.
Well, did you ever know anybody, John, that was actually supposed to use the lick of this place?
I can remember one old man here, Pat Cairn, they call him. He lived in his own here, and he used to always tell these stories at night about them coming in here. And they gathered up all these ferns, you can see them, you'll see them around here later. They gathered them all up and put them down on the floor here and burned them. And up at the upper end of it there's another, you can see another part of a chimney. Whatever smoke went out there. And then, when they got up the good heaps, it crawled out again through the bottom. This here is all covered up before, but the slabs have gone away now. The weather and everything has taken them away, but this is all covered up, and it's just completely covered over, like, and you couldn't see it only the hole for getting in here and the smoke for getting out up at the top. And there's a great heat on it. And it didn't take them long when they were here to get the fire up on the place, I know, but according to him, they used to go in here and stand and dance about in the ferns and the ashes of the stuff to get warmed up, and then they jumped into the water.
Well, they must have had some sort of a pool or something about here, John.
That's, you see, them, that's the part of the pool there swept away, you see.
Oh, is that part of the
that's
pool
part
there?
Of
so they would have come out here,
and come out there, crawled out there and jumped into the water, straight across into the water.
I think you're really kidding me.
You can see all the ferns around here now where they're growing. These are all, they gathered these all up, and part of these horn bushes that you can see around here too, that they called up this one for fuel and burned it up for a, and had a great heat in it. It hadn't too far to go for the fuel.
How long ago, John, would you say that would be? Maybe 100 years.
That man talking, he was a great age when he died. He was, I was talking to him when he was about maybe well into his 80s anyhow, and according to him, when he was a young fella then, that would be, it would make it up to nearly 100 years ago since there were anybody in at all.
Sam Smith's down there, right at the church there. Mm. There was a dance at Sam Smith's one night. He used to be dancing there regularly. Mm. Went from Feeny was down, there was Bob, myself, and Pierce Lynch and this. And we all went out and we landed down in the bus. The winter old Sam saw us all coming in, the trouble was near hand. And he looked at the door to say, the dance is over, and goes the fiddle to the bag.
up to where?
Up to Park Fair.
Oh, aye, right.
Among innocent people.
Yeah.
And a few pounds in the park, they bought a few lambs of 6 and 9 foot apiece.
Right.
That's a long time ago now. About 10 minutes ago already, yeah. And took them home, but they all died through the winter. And I was up in April again. And bought a few lambs, we got a few. I was gathered up again, and some of the boys were sympathising with them. Simple old farmers, you know, mm-hmm. Very simple. Mm-hmm. They're all they're simple yet not any new friend. But the far side of the street, but he was listening. He was chewing away to the back end. Oh, the back of down here. And he done this with his finger, they called me over. So see, son, I heard you say to them, men, they lost all the big lambs you bought. He says, I bet they all died, there's something wrong with them. Well, he says, them men's far too smart over there. I'll tell you, but I wouldn't tell them, he says, how you lost no more sheep. I said, how? Man, the eyes are sitting out in my head. Well, he says, if you lost no more sheep, keep on, he says.
Just think about what Willie John Doe said one time.
Watch it.
They asked Mary to dance. She said, I'm not very good at it. Well, he said, we'll run around the time empty.
It is
really
in this school.
Two. That's the two.
And many children about it. Many children about the school.
30 or something like that. You know, what they were saying.
I just received a letter from my home in Ireland. The scribble so familiar was my mother's feeble hand. A house that rang with music and of laughter now is still. Dear Denny, it's so lonely now among the Wicklow hills. As I gaze across the mountains, I relive a moment's joy. The same old Wicklow mountains where you rambled as a boy. Your photo as a child that pictures by your bedside still. And each night I pray that you'll come back home among the Wicklow hills. Do you remember long ago when in summer you would stroll down where the crystal mountain streams to where the slaney waters roll? Do you recall a young companion who talks about you still? And you know who she is waiting to among the Wicklow hills. As I gaze across the mountains, I relive a moment's joy. The same old Wicklow mountains where you rambled as a boy. Your photo as a child that pictures by your bedside still. And each night I pray that you'll come back home among the Wicklow hills.
Donkey and the turf from Aston Gear, isn't that right? Years of transfer. Away back on the Dungiven Street to dug it up. We'll see if Feeny had a lot at that time.
What was that brand you said?
From the Dungiven Street away back in the 50s something. And they dug it away up. Right. Big deep tracks on it.
I remember that, just the catapults.
Yeah. And I had a session with the Donkey there, and then went over the brew one day. He scared at the machinery, you know.
Oh,
sometimes the donkey runs backwards instead of
forwards. Further than the phone.
Over the Holy Land, 2 years ago. And they bus over the city to Marnock and then went to France and then landed in Jericho. And they changed buses there.
Right.
And they said there was a boy beating a donkey along the road. So the bus driver got out and he said to the bloke, giving this donkey a hiding. And he said, you shouldn't be doing that. He said, that was the only conveyance Jesus had when he was in there. Mm-hmm. It was a donkey. And Christ, he said, with this donkey, they never seen in Jerusalem.
proper priest at that. Okay, you know, just bowers, bows that time, you know, and she's just bowing the table and a wee pet pig was running around the floor, you know. Pet pig was gnawing away at the priest's foot, you know, with no nose, you know. And the priest says, well, woman's got to see a wee pet pig's wild friend, lady. And she says, funny enough, that's the bowl. She's on here to get the data.
But you tell me this, so this traveller came round to a farmer, you see. And he said to the farmer, where's John today? Oh, he said, he must have a wee bit funny with a bit of an drancher.
Oh.
Where's James? Oh, James, a wee bit funny too, with a bit of an drancher. Where's the other boy? Oh, he mentioned some others, daddy. Oh, he said, he was the same. And there's a wee boy sitting up on a tree, on a branch of a tree, cackling like a hen. He said, where's you? He said, what's he doing up there? He said, he thinks he's laying eggs. He said, you should put him on too. No, I said, well, what put him on home, you need the eggs.
If you look at the mass in the houses, and they had on an open fire and a huge big pot of potatoes. And after the mass and all, and someone asked why they had so many potatoes on. And they said, well, when three priests and all the family and the pigs get their share out of it, there'll be none left.
I love it,
Eric. No, I'm not. You know, it's wild bad harvest. Right. Some wee boy, you know, they worked that time in the farm and drove him up in the horse and carried the trap. And he's rubbing away in there and he says, I must mind a good day to pray for good weather. This wee boy looked up, he says, I don't know, the wrong bones from that direction, so whether they're good news or not.
You're
peaceful,
mate.
Well, I didn't grow up in the area, so I don't know
The man, he was employed with Josh at the mall, and he's drawn away shoes and he's dumping them elsewhere. So isn't he talking to the man on the mall, lost some time? But Jack was a young boy, and he took the horse and the shirt and all, took all away, but there was no noise in the shoes, so he took all away and put them to the shed and closed the door. And the man, he came in, looked all around, took the horse, took off his shirt, off the coat out the lane. And the lane, came to the horse and shirt and looked under the shed, up under the yard. And Jack's mother, he couldn't appear because she would have seen him. And he couldn't say, Lord, the horse.
I don't know.
I'm an awful old man, so the horse was lost all day.
An old woman lived beside us one time.
Do you know her name now?
I know, I'm not going
to name her. Could be Rosie Jordan.
It was just something the same, but. Anyway, her husband died anyway, and she was at the graveside, you see, and
they're all going around shaking hands with him, sorry for your trouble. No. But one old woman with her, she was lasting up there. She said, what happened to him anyway? Well, she said, I'll tell you what happened to him. She said, I was making dinner at the time, and I sent him out to the cabbage patch, was out to wonder, you see, out to get you one. She's a long time away, and I looked out, he was lying dead between the drills. So she said, that must have been a terrible shot for you. She said, it wasn't it? She said, I go, had to open the can of peas.
It was hired in Kelly's Terry Dream. And Dennis Feeny, very talented Dennis Feeny up here.
That's right, the big tall man, wasn't it?
Dennis used to get all the lies and the cult that told him every met there was terrible lies. But he'd come over to my father in the shop, you see, and he'd come out with some of these lies, and my father would say, don't you repeat that again, that's lies, so terrible lies. One of them has told me what to tell him. Watch out, if you weren't Wednesday, what to tell him, you see. The story I was to tell him, Dennis knew it when he would come back, he'd be in Kelly's, and he would tell it in Kelly's house, and it was against the Kelly's, you see. But he would spout it out. So anyhow, Dennis came in, and he was sitting in the window, and my father went out to the shop out to get something, and I got a chance at Dennis, and I went over and I was telling Dennis this story, you see. But Dennis was listening to me, and and my father came out and he got me telling you the wrong way, and he made a clatter of me. He said, don't listen to him, Dennis, he's telling you lies. And he haunted me, wanting more than to tell me those lies. So anyhow, Dennis and them was watching for Dennis coming back over, and they were all in waiting to come in and tell this story in Kelly's, you see. But Dennis came in and there was no story. So they didn't know what happened. And Dennis says to him, says he, were you over in Feeny at all? I was, says he. No news over there. No news, says he. That's only he didn't hear something else, you see. You know, says he, that young Dad McKinley's a grandfather, so he would tell you, but because his father would tell you nothing. And Johnny was up the roof with a shovel battering to put it out, and there was an old man staying with him there for a while. What the hell did it call him? But when Johnny saw he wasn't fit to get the fire out, he calls down to your man, see, would you remove the dirt from the dressers and he could be all burned out? The man went to the dirt from the dresser and he come to the door and threw them out. A band come out of Derry and there was this old fellow, they'd been given him a few drinks and he was playing the violin, you see. And you know, how about sharing all the way to the
station? Oh, I went home one night and I thought I knocked him in the room for sure.
Oh,
I knocked him one, the money was in bed. Straight away, he knocked the one. You long in bed, money? She said, 5 foot four. Money was there then.
Thank you.
go, and we'll all go together to pluck wild mountain pine all around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie, go? I wouldn't if my love should leave. I will surely find another where the wild mountains lie. Goes around in the blooming heather. Thank you.
that I think we'll ever do agree to enjoy tonight. And first of all, I'd like us to give a big hand to the ladies who presented the place. Thank you very much indeed, very well done. And also next in line is Liam Mullen for the music. All the rest of you who came out tonight, I'm sure you've all have been sitting at the fire, enjoying your evening and looking at television, etc. But this night, you won't agree that this is unequal television at all. No matter how good it is. So, but thank you all.
To ask you to do penance is to to ask you to relax. For hell is fun compared to work and taking Cairn and flax. We washed our hands and faces and we disinfect our clothes. We scrub behind our kneecaps and we peep between our toes. We dose our hair in our oil and we rub the down our backs. But sure as hell you still can smell the painting Cairn and flax. We disinfect our clothes. We scrub behind our kneecaps and we clean between our toes. We dose our hair in hair oil and we run the down our backs. But sure as hell you still can smell the paint and flax. We wash our hands and faces and we disinfect our clothes. We scrub behind our kneecaps and we clean between our toes. We dose our hair in hair oil and we run the down our backs. But sure as hell you still can smell the paint.